special post. Obviously, it's on video, and I'm here up in Mendocino, California, which is the coast by the Wild Sea. And I'm here with my teacher and friend, Liz Migliorelli. Liz Migliorelli.
Got it.
Who I've been working with all year on folk magic and medicine of my own European ancestry. And it's been really powerful. If you've been reading for me for a while, you know, it's been a really beautiful way for me to connect more with my sense of self, my sense of belonging, my relationship with the land, my relationship with people in my community. It's activated me in social justice causes and environmental causes. And I wanted you to meet the woman behind it and just formally, I think it's really important that you credit your teachers to formally say, this woman, thank you so much for all that you have shared with me.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's been so fun.
Do you want to tell the people? You can just talk to me.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, like who you are and what you do and what you care about, what you stand for.
Yeah. So I am an herbalist, and I went to herb school many, many years ago and had some issues with it not really being grounded in any ancestral tradition, and that it just felt like it was very clinical, like Western mind based, and just that it was very linear, and I didn't really know like where a lot of the knowledge was coming from. It, you know, was very textbook based, and so it inspired me to teach this class that I now teach called the Folk Medicine and Magic of Old Europe, which is a class that encourages people to explore their ancestral traditions and learn about their ancestry and where they're from and how their people connected to the land and what the medicine of their own lineages carry. So that's the main, one of the main themes of the class, I would say. It kind of spirals, but so that's a main, I guess, I'm trying to think about the best way to put it, but that's like one of the main threads. And that's really, really important to me to be on this earth as a person, and kind of understanding how I relate to other people is understanding how my ancestors relate to other people. And I'm an herbalist, and I see clients, and I have a product line called Sister Spinster, and I teach herb classes that hopefully inspire enchantment of the world.
That's right. That's your like intention and purpose.
Yes.
To re-enchant.
Yes.
Yeah.
The enchantment of the world.
Yeah, beautiful. So this ancestry piece, it's kind of hot right now. Everyone's getting the DNA tests, which is pretty cool, I think, because the word ancestor is now like used more freely and is seen as sort of less weird. Even the word witch is used more freely.
Mm-hmm.
You tell this story in our class, which I really appreciate, about like how you've come to deeply understand your own European indigeneity through dreams.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering if you could share anything about that, because there's a lot of people have written me or talked to me about how they either don't have access to talking to their family about, or it goes dark, or there's trauma and they've purposely cut that out, or they're all dead.
Mm-hmm.
And so you've talked about dream space as being a place where people can also connect with their ancestors.
Yeah, and it's so profound. I think once that acceptance of dreams being sources of information is honored, and I think that's kind of the first hurdle, I think, that it can be really hard for people to get over or face and accept, is just like our dreams are really powerful and they're legitimate and they are so important to our souls and ourselves, and they have been forever, you know. And this in itself is a form of medicine, is dreaming. And there are people in all communities that are big dreamers, and that's just kind of how it's always been to be human. human. And so once there's an acceptance of, yes, dreams are potent and dreams are powerful, then I think we can kind of lean into dream work as a tool for remembering ancestral ways or ancestral wisdom. So one of the things that I learned in my classes that I took, I took an ancestral, a Slavic dreaming circle class with my teacher, Atava Garcia Spazecki, who runs the Ancestral Apothecary School in Oakland. And we just did a lot of exercises around kind of creating your own dream vocabulary. And I think that's really important when you are looking to dreams for information, is to just kind of assess what is the symbolism that's there for you and what kind of dreamer are you? Because you can read tons of books about, you know, what like teeth falling out in a dream means, but that can be so different for you and then it can mean something different for me. And so really what I try to encourage is for people to just kind of get familiar with their own symbolism and
to never read those dream dictionaries.
Yeah, I say that pretty clearly.
Yeah. I was like, got it, they're gone.
None of that. Yeah, I mean, I guess it could be helpful if it resonates with you, but I think it's really important to just kind of track the patterns for yourself and to see what forms. And it's, again, it's just another form of deepening your own connection to your own intuition, which is the most powerful thing that we can do, is really honor that. So I encourage people to create their own dream vocabulary, essentially. And then through that, find the vocabulary in which the ancestors are speaking to you. And that can be, that can look like so many different things. I mean, for me, it's been a combination of like bookish research and researching like what are the foods that my ancestors ate, and then like seeing if any of those foods show up in dreams, or you know, what kind of plants would my ancestors have worked with, and then maybe searching for that in the dream world a little bit, or literally just setting an intention before bed and focusing on a certain ancestor and calling them in and kind of recording my dreams and seeing if they showed up. And to also just know that like dreams are very non-linear.
Yeah.
And and that an ancestor can show up in 2 weeks, or they could have maybe already come in a dream, or maybe they don't look like a human in the dream either. And so again, it's really about you honoring your own experience of what's happening in your dream and really giving power to that.
Yeah. I love how you talked about the foods and like the folklore, and I think that's been really powerful in my own ancestral work, both in dream space and waking space, is to look for clues, because a lot, my family, both my mother's and father's side, have been in the United States for many generations. Mm-hmm. And so when I look to like my European indigeneity, I don't have a lot of threads to pull, mm-hmm. like that's written down mm-hmm. or passed down. And so it's really helpful to look to areas that like aren't affected by empire. So it's like the folk tales, the fairy tales, the foods, the music. Mm-hmm. And that's been what's activated me in both like waking and dream space. Because I remember when you were like, have a dream journal and like call some of the dreams, and I'd like put out like dandelion tea, and I'd like burn my mugwort, and I'd like take my dream tincture that we made together, and then like nothing would come, or it'd be like some really funny sex dream or something, and it just like what, I don't know. And then what happened was I've been connecting more to the food. You have us do this ancestral potluck, which is like off the chain, so fun. And the music, and then really it's been reading the folk and fairy tales mm-hmm. and like the origin stories and the myths that has activated mm-hmm. something deeper for me. Mm-hmm. So that's mm-hmm. been really helpful.
Yeah, and I think using all of those tools are ways to just awaken that memory that does live in you. And it's not always just accessible from dreams. I feel like dreams are so informed by our waking world too. And so the more we can kind of surround ourselves with the intention of connecting with our ancestors in our waking world, then that's going to be reflected more in our dream state too. And so, yeah, I think like full on just diving into the often like the precursor to like how you got here. Like all of our ancestors danced and then like went and did it.
Yeah.
You know, right. Like a lot of like folk dances are like very sexy. And so like that's even just like a part of like your own embodiment today is like honoring those dances and doing them.
Yeah. So one of your people is Italian.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember you showed us, you went to Italy on a pilgrimage, and you showed us a video of the tarantella.
Mm-hmm.
And like how you were showing us this man and woman, and they were like dancing around each other, and you were like, this is basically sex, but yeah. In like this really beautiful, ritualized, joyful way.
Mm-hmm.
And that made me start thinking about like Irish jig dancing and like my obsession with river dance as a child.
What need was that needing?
Yeah, that's a good point about the dancing.
Yeah.
Yeah, so who are your people?
My people come from southern Italy and central Italy, Naples, and a tiny little town called San Giorgio, kind of outside of Cassino. And then also from Poland, from Warsaw, but before that, I don't know. I haven't been able to trace that back. But I know it's from somewhere else other than Warsaw because Poland means people of the field and cities are newer. So I'm not sure yet, and that's okay. And then I have Celtic ancestors and Anglo-Saxon and some unknown. I mean, I did the 23andMe test and I have like general ideas, but you know, specifics, it's really hard to say exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
And I love how you're saying the names of the tribes because I've noticed talking to people who've done the DNA tests that they get really attached to the nation. Like I am Irish or I am Scottish.
Mm-hmm.
I know I've been saying that for years and I like how you're talking because the Celtic people were like major conquerors that went up and down like all the way up to like the northern lands and all the way as south as like how south, at least England, southern modern day England.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so, and I know I have like Nordic heritage and that could have been from Ireland. It's so hard to know. So some people get really tripped up in the nationality.
Yeah, piece. And it's not super helpful because nations change borders and, you know, like Italy wasn't a country until like the mid 1800s. So
that's crazy.
Yeah. That is crazy.
It's like yesterday.
Yeah, I know. And so the form of national identity isn't actually very helpful when we're thinking of ancestral work. It's really land-based and tribal-based. And I think for me, that's been helpful, too, to just not get caught up in that kind of like more linear Western mind thinking of just like understanding the spiral of like movement of people and that, yeah, my report can show that I have like 10% like Finnish in there, but that's probably like because like Celtic people moved up and through that area, you know, so it's just an interesting way to diversify that perspective a little bit.
Yeah, and can maybe be a little frustrating for those of us who are seeking like deep home feelings of like wanting to own a certain culture or heritage. I know this whole concept of whiteness is like devoid of culture, and so it can feel really frustrating. But what's been helpful to me, since I am such a mix, and I think I'm just getting into it, so there's so much more to know and understand, is to just see the joy of this being a lifelong unfolding and journey. So right now I'm like really into my Celtic heritage, but there's so many, I still haven't gotten into my Nordic heritage and my like Germanic, and there's so many parts, there's like Polish that I will get to when I have that desire and excitement and resonance to go for. But when I get really caught up in like national identity, it's really contracting and doesn't feel good.
Yeah. I totally agree.
Yeah.
And I kind of like pay attention to the ancestors that are speaking more loudly or more present at my door. And that's kind of like who I work with for a while. And then someone else shows up and I go there. And yeah, that's very fluid.
Totally. Mm-hmm. So it's been said that we're in the age of loneliness. And that we're more connected than ever as humanity, and that we're also who are watching who are like, I'm so interested, I'm lit up by what they're saying, and I feel like I have such a craving to belong, and I really don't feel it. Like, what would you, where would you tell them to start, or what would you say to them?
I would really start with looking at your cultural traditions and lineages and looking at that. But I guess even before that, I would really start with just like connection to the plants around you and the land around you, because yeah. It's that easy.
Sense, I think, of place.
Yeah, and just really feeling at home with the trees and the plants and our neighbors that are here right now, that our living community. I think it's really easy to, when we do ancestral work, to like really romanticize like this like past version of community that was.
I'm for sure that person.
Yeah, I am too.
I'm like trying to dress like I'm not alive in 2017.
Yeah, and I mean, it's like, I think we all crave that, like, that village that doesn't exist anymore, and like that's that loneliness of like wanting that kind of village again. But so for me, I think like realizing that there are ways in which I can cultivate that now in the village, like me going to the post office as like my place for like town news is like a really big part of that, you know.
It's my chiropractor.
Yeah,
she knows everything.
Yeah, exactly. You're like, oh, how's this person doing, and you get all of the news that you need there. But so for me, that's like really where I try to like focus the most, I think, is just like, where am I right now? What plants are around me now that I can connect with? And, you know, also looking at like the history of the land that I'm on now today, and understanding, you know, the extreme displacement that has happened for me to be on this land, and, you know, like looking at what all of that means. And I think that just has created a much greater sense of connection to place through like having a relationship with the land around me. And then, and then I would say, you know, just something that has been so helpful for me is just looking at like ways in which my ancestors dealt with loneliness. Like there are folk tales about that, and there are folk tales about death and being, you know, winter, and like these kind of general themes that we're in right now seasonally as well. And I don't know, I guess it's just for me, even if there's not a specific answer, I think it is nice to like hear the resonance of the theme throughout time, and just knowing that like, oh, you know, I'm not experiencing anything new right now by being lonely too, because this is also just like that's a human feeling to a certain extent, and just kind of having an understanding of that has been helpful for me. I'm trying to think like where else. I mean, there's so many ways in which one could take that, like,
well, let's take it with the season of winter.
Yeah.
Since that's what we're entering into, depending on where you live in the world, you're like really feeling winter or not yet, or I know it's like for me, living in Northern California, it's like knocking on the door. Like we had frost the other morning when I came outside, and I was like, oh, winter is coming.
It's here.
It's here. Right. And I'm someone who struggled with winter growing up. I have met so many people who really struggle with winter, and like, what do they tell you? Like, get sun on your face, get a sad lamp, like all these things. But what are some traditions, ancestral traditions, at least from your lineages and old European lineages, that have been helpful since we're pulling through that thread of our ancestors were probably deeply lonely and felt isolated and like couldn't go work on the land during this time and it was dark. Like what did they do? What could we do?
Well, I think there's, right now, there's this element of embracing fire and embracing light and just, you know, like really doing some sun worship at this time of year. So I think it's one of the things that I think to me adds to this loneliness that we were just talking about is like looking at Christmas lights. And like, I have this understanding of, you know, where this like light, you know, all these little plastic lights came from. It's like from this older tradition of having candles lit throughout the long nights of winter to kind of like bring the sun into the home and to kind of look at like a community warmth around you. And then to like, now when I go outside, I grew up in New York on the East Coast, and like Christmas lights are like really big.
Yeah.
Christmas is like big in New York. And it's just like one of those things that would just kind of make me feel like even more alone, because there's a part of it that almost feels fake, that it's like we're like using this like false light to light up our darkness, where I'm like, oh, what brings me light is like connection with community and like having potlucks at this time of year and gathering and feasting. And I think that's a big part of like the tradition that still has lived on, that like this is the time of year where people are like festive and have parties and, you know, they really gather with community. But I the whole like false Christmas light thing is just a really interesting thing.
Yeah, you and I talked last night about fake trees.
Yeah.
I was like, how do you feel about fake trees? And you're like, I'm not into them. And then another girl was like, I love them because I grew up with them. And we were like, cool.
Yeah.
Good for you.
We don't like them.
Does not feel real.
Yeah, it doesn't feel real. My grandma had a fake tree that like you like would press a button and it like emitted Christmas songs at you. It was so jarring. I mean, I think I liked it as a kid because it was entertaining, but when I think about it now, I'm like, oh, you know, like, I would much rather, like, be outside with a tree at this point. But, you know, I get that isn't available or accessible to everyone, and that's fine. And I think for me, just, like, having an understanding of like, okay, at this time of year, people really did focus on their community and like who it was that they like to gather around. So even when I have like these really frustrating family times sometimes over the holidays, or, you know, like I feel like a lot of the holidays are stressful for people and triggering.
Sure.
And yeah. And I think for me, one of the things that I like to kind of switch in that framework is just like, these, you know, I'm going to try to surround myself with like people that do help me like light my inner fire, and people that do help me feel creative and inspired like in the darkest of days. And that is something that is a tradition, you know, of just like surrounding yourself with the warmth of community. So that's one thing that is like easy.
Yeah.
And we're probably already doing it. And just having that little shift of perspective for me, I think, has been really helpful. It's not being like, oh, I have to go hang out with these people. It's like, actually, these are my people. And like, I'm going to try to like find what I love in everyone around me, which is really nice.
Yeah.
But like, I don't know, there's so many other things, like candle making at this time of year, you know.
Love that candle making.
Yeah.
Love it. I brought her some candles today.
I love them.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think like anything that is just kind of like our ancestors at this time of year in Europe, they were really focused on what is it that keeps the hearth lit. And that can be like on a physical sense of like cooking and, you know, just staying warm near the fire, storytelling by the fire. But then it also can just be like, who is it that you want to bring into your life, into your hearth, to be well fed with you? And who is it that like holds the vision with you for the spring to come? And really using this time to like hold that seed in the darkness for the actions that you want to have come forth in spring. And that is like just really fun for me to think about and act on.
Yeah. And I also like to just give my permission to have a little dip.
Yeah.
You know, like the sun is dying and we'll be reborn. Like it's dark and it's natural to feel a little down. Like energy is descending in the plants. Like everyone's just coming down before we come back up. And that's just giving myself permission to be like, I'm going to have a few sad days, or I'm going to sleep a lot more. And like, that's ancestral and part of this connection that we're all in, and that's helped us, instead of like drinking way more coffee and trying to like power through and like shame myself.
Yeah, for like your lack of productivity at this time of year or something. I know it's really intense because we have this like cultural driven, like you have to be really productive at this time of year. You have to spend a lot of money.
Yes.
You have to like just produce and engage.
Squeeze
and
the most out of the year.
Yeah, exactly. And like there's like deadlines to meet. And really the whole season is just like slow down, like bring your energy inward and do your dream work, like hibernate.
It's the season of dreaming.
Yeah. And so I really, when I have clients that like come to me with kind of seasonal depression, I'm like, yeah, I do want to help you feel better, but I also want you to know that like part of this is coming from like this like outside cultural pressure as well of like you needing to be productive and produce. And I think if we can kind of just help ourselves shift our perspective around that of being like, you know what, it's okay to be low energy at this time of year and just accept that. And like, what are ways in that we can like slowly nourish ourselves? We don't have to be productive. We can nourish. That's like a very different framework. And it's helpful for me because I still do that. I like, I've been up late, like really late.
I worked so much this past week.
Yeah.
I was like, everybody rest.
Yeah.
I'm gonna rest too soon.
And I don't do
it. It's so ingrained.
Yeah. There is a thing that happens too where like I do also get really inspired at this time of year because it like feels so holy in many regards. Just like with, like I always like to think about like what is the magic that I can make in the dark? And sometimes I do. I'm like, I gotta be up all night making things. And that, you know, that's fine too. I fluctuate and I think for me, what's been helpful is just like shifting the perspective of like, I need to be doing something certain instead of just checking in with myself day to day and be like, how am I doing today? What am I feeling today? And then going in accordance with that.
Yeah, winter is such a teacher.
Yeah.
Just really realizing that every year more and more.
Yeah.
The less I stop, like the less I fight it.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. The fighting it is the thing that I just have to like drop. But it's hard to do.
Right, yeah. Well, thank you so much for chatting with me and this phone that's recording us right now, but there's all these people behind it. I'm so appreciative for you and your work. So happy to Instagram for introducing us. Thank you, Instagram.
Yeah, thank you, Instagram.
And, happy solstice to everyone. And
happy solstice.
Yeah, thank you again.
Thank you.